discussion. You all have tons of information, and we'll be able to inform each other a great deal during this discussion as well as I will. But more importantly, what you need and what you want and what you're interested in will dictate what this next hour 10 minutes is all about. So let's make it an open forum, question forum, where, okay, this is what I'm struggling for, this is what I need more of, or whatever, and then we'll see where the discussion takes us. Sound good?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right? So fire away, what are we talking about today?
Oh boy.
Don't worry, we have an hour and 10 minutes, so we'll get a whole bunch of different topics in here.
I think there's a lot of experiences with that barbershop arranging, but I think some of us, including me, sometimes struggle with how to translate contemporary music into barbershop without making it just sound like barbershop. Like the King Singers this morning, that like formal style, it's the way that some of our contemporary music gets some. Either it doesn't sound like the original, or loses some of the flavor, so I would be interested to talk about that.
Yes. Good. Okay, so let's talk about that. Okay, I'll do the chalk thing just so it all feels formal. Let me get over here. It's not even money's worth. We're walking all the way over here looking good. So let's talk at this from two different perspectives, because I think there are two different elements to it. Whoever raised things was this is great. Number one, let's look at it from an arranging standpoint. When you're dealing with barbershop, you're dealing with homophonic music. You're really looking at things, with rare exception, that are block chords, people singing the same words at the same time, because the focus is on overtones. The focus is on making four voices sound like one voice. The fundamental job of contemporary a cappella, at least as I have laid it out and designed it, is in some ways the exact opposite. You first of all don't want people to sound like people in a lot of cases, and you want there to be many layers of sound. When I started arranging stuff, and a lot of it was transcripted in essence, I wanted to create the experience of hearing the kind of song that you hear on the radio, which is voices. So what does that mean? That means many layers, right? Now, if you've got a barbershop course of 50 people, you don't need to divide them up. 12 for 13, boom, 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 times 4. You can literally have a solo and then a trio that steps forward and sings with them as well. You can have a few people doing a guitar type line. You can have another layer of strings behind them. I mean, this is just to like start to get you to think like this.
Sure.
Where you like think about disco, you have this kind of and let me go on a side tangent here. Instrumental imitation. There are going to be a lot of tangents in this next hour, so put your neck braces on. It's going to be whiplash. Instrumental imitation does not require you to sound exactly like the instrument. What you need to do is you need to sound more like an instrument than anything else. And more importantly, and this, I don't have any like science that's backed this up, but what I know about brain science reinforces this. Your brain processes information in different centers. You have a kinesthetic sense for movement, you have a linguistic sense center, you have a musical center, et cetera, et cetera. When you hear someone singing words, your brain is getting information in the linguistic and in the musical center. When you hear someone sounding like an instrument, your brain is saying, okay, that's not words, what is that? So it's not going to the linguistic center at all. Number one, you don't want anything to go to the linguistic center. And number two, then your brain starts to categorize it. What does that sound like? It sounds more like a trumpet than anything else. It's a trumpet. If I did that in a trumpet play, you'd be like, actually, they're not that. They're in the ballpark, but they're not in the ball club together. You know what I mean? But you have to just get close enough. Plus, phrasing it the right way, using your hands to show, like, there are different ways that we cheat and convince people that it gets over closer to that side. So, how do you make voices sound more like that? Number one, you stay away from words, from linguistics. So, when a bass is singing boom, 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 or people are singing do, 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 bum, and do are words in English, right? So, even if you had someone singing dum-dum-dum-dum, it sounds like a thumb. Get rid of the vowel. THM isn't a word. And when I do that, I all of a sudden sound three, four more times like an instrument. And it's simply from removing the vowel. Or if I went, I've got a vowel in there, but it doesn't sound, it sounds, it's clearly vocal, but it doesn't sound
wordy,
right? This is all, it's all about the perception of the audience. So the key to making these kind of sounds work is to make sure that it's not a word in the language, the dominant language. In France, you would use different sounds, different vowels, different, right? Because they have different words. So you've got guitar strings, and sometimes you'll just want to put a pad of voices behind things and just have people in a big block chord. It's really about layers. So if you have someone going, and then you have another over here, and then underneath all of that, you start to get this cool three-dimensional layer of sound. And everything that I've done, that I've just given you as an example to try to set these things going in your mind, they're all simple triad. It's not necessarily about complexity. In fact, the more complex you get with your harmonies, the more you start to create confusion and difficulty tuning and things like that. And even though as arrangers, you guys are going to want to, put in more hard chords and harmonies. Remember, most pop music is based around four chords. Seven chords aren't very common unless it's almost used as a color note, like in a blues tune. Like you get those sevens and dominant sevens. Occasionally, but not even that often, and you don't get a 5-7 chord of pop music nowadays. It's rare, right? Because chords have a harmonic function, but they don't primarily exist for harmonic progression's sake. Do you know that, that Don't Stop Believing progression? That four-chord progression? Right. And all of that, or starting a different part of the progression, that is the equivalent now to what the doo-wop progression was. The right? The 1, 6, 4, 5. That became such a, beyond a cliche, it was like the paper upon which doo-wop was written. There were other progressions or whatever, but the blues are not about harmonic progression. The blues are, here's this form. You say a line, you say a line, you say a different line, and rhymes with it, and repeat. And you've got the 12-bar blues form. So
you go from 1, 6, 4, 5 to 1, 5, 6, 4.
5. Right, exactly. But again, no, believe me, I wish there were more. Yeah. I prefer the 70s to Steely Dan. I'm with you. Except, nobody listens to music necessarily for the complexity of it, and it takes 6. We like, think of it as food. We like our food spicier. If you're on a range, you probably like your food to a level of spiciness that is the equivalent of somebody from Thailand and how spicy it is. If you go to a Thai restaurant and you ask them for Thai spicy, or you're in Thailand and they look at you and they're like, oh, Ramdai, we make you American style, so I can do it. No, I'm not Thai style. They'll look at you and literally be like, no. I traveled with my friend and he actually learned Thai because he taught English in Thailand, and he said, no, I want Thai spicy. And then they bring you the food. And you're like,
yeah.
So that's the level that we like our harmonic complexity and our harmonic rhythm also, which is a fancy way of saying that the rate at which chords change. Right? Mm-hmm. Like if we were singing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound is. And there's your first chord change, right? Yeah. But in barbershop, you're like, another chord, amazing chord, grace, chord. That was sweet. Like we like our chords 24 times spicier than the average person is used to. So just remember that when you're dealing with pop music, you may be like, gosh, this is so simple. But there are four dimensions to all sound. This is something we're on a tangent again. We'll only have time for this one question, so you know. All sound is physics. All sound exists within four dimensions of physics, and anytime as arrangers you guys run into a wall, you want to think about and address it from those perspectives, right? So what are they?
Time.
Duration of note, okay? So the duration of the note with spaces in between it creates rhythm. So this note here is shorter than this note. We're talking about the building blocks of sound. And of course, I'm showing you waves, it's compression, decompression, right?
Pitch,
you said, right, which technically is frequency, okay? Different frequencies at one after another creates melody. Different frequencies at the same time creates harmony, right? So, for instance, this note is higher than this note, right? You see where I'm going with this, okay? Number three. Amplitude, you're talking my neck. You're in the right room. Amplitude, right? This note is louder than this note, even though they're the same, right? And that's loudness, that's volume. And then, number four, where everything gets crazy. It's basically it's your overtones, right? So a wave, unless you've got a sine wave created by a computer, they're not going to look like this. They're going to look like this. Because it's this and quieter inside of this,
right.
And then inside of this, and then even more, so you add them all up. Boom, 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 because of all of our overtones. So, the reason I brought this up in this particular juncture is Barbershop thinks 70%, I would say, about frequency, because it's all about pitches with each other. Right? 25% about timbre, because it's about blend and it's about bringing over tones. And then your durations and notes and stuff like that. I mean, we're talking about but the timbre factor in particular, you're thinking about that. Now, when you're talking about contemporary acapella, your pitches and your frequencies matter, but not as much, and it's not necessarily about bringing over tones. And when you're talking about timbre, it's not about making them all align so you get overtones. It's about different layers of timbre
to get up to each other.
Barbershop is going and getting a one bowl meal. Barbershop is a stew, and it has nice ingredients in it, and that's your whole meal. Everything is in it. Contemporary acapella, to extend this analogy, is a smorgasbord. It's a sampler platter. It's when you go to Indian food and you get like tons of those little metal dishes with all these different ingredients in it. It's tapas. Yeah. And then you take a bite, and you take a bite, and you take a bite, and you hear it, and you have all these layers going on. But something that you need to know is in contemporary acapella, duration, aka rhythm, is much bigger deal. Because contemporary acapella leans more towards popular music, which is more currently closely adhering to the African as opposed to the European traditions that come through. The music world, right? Mm-hmm. So having that crystal high tone, having the bass boom, like all of those things feed in. So it may feel at times like, oh, contemporary acapella is easier, these chords are easier, but you're only looking at one dimension of what's going on musically. And tamarally, you're trying to create one dimension. In essence, or occasionally the lead will sing a line in the background, sing ooh, or the lead will do arpeggiation. But these are slight nods towards the tradition of instrumental music, right? Which has all of this going on. And also, dynamics exist within barbershop. But again, think of it as the Blue Angels, where you guys are all playing in formation. If you've got dynamics in a barbershop song, it's almost always everybody moving as a unit together because you want it to sound like one voice. Whereas the dynamics, sometimes the whole group will come down and get louder, but you're pushing and pulling and playing with different elements. Which is why sometimes in an arrangement, I'll have an ooh against an ah, to use the most basic sense, because I want this to be loud, but that to be quiet. Or you play with different formats, you play with different timbres, you play with different rhythms that end up pulsing. Like, I almost like those keyboards. You can have one part going, it's 1970s, so it's not this crazy thing. You have one part going, and above you, and then beneath you have, so you get that major seven in there, which some people bring out and they're like, major seven, right? But you have them, you're hearing this, right? But the sound is happening all the time. You're creating rhythm without the note stopping. In barbershop, it's either the rhythm is created by sound or no sound. We're saying, and this is happening, right? Is that right? Where you have these variations, and so.
But I can see that coming into barbershop. Even into a contest, interesting arrangement that would still stay within the constraints of contest, but to have that kind of creativity where you're actually accentuating different vowels at different times, I mean, I don't think music does it.
Not at all. And I played with some ideas along those lines when I did the big closing song I did for a forefront when they were singing at the barbershop a couple weeks ago. I have them singing, and then they came, but I wanted it to feel like a string section was playing. So rather than just singing, I had them morph their vowel.
To what? What do you think? How do you make a string?
Well, I'll teach you a string.
Without being a word, right?
Well, but first of all, a simple way to do it is to do it without being a word. Which is a very subtle way to overtone sing. In fact, all vowels is overtone singing, right?
Mm-hmm.
In essence, if that doesn't make sense to you, like I said, we're tangent city, right? So all sound is one of these four elements. So if I sing a note with the same version, the same frequency, and the same amplitude on different vowels, A, E, A, O, U, same vowel, same duration, same amplitude, whatever, let me connect them for you. A, A, O, let me exaggerate that. A, you hear that? You hear one second.
Yes.
Barbershop doesn't live in the cracks. Barbershop draws, this is your proper oo, this is your proper ah, because you need a single signpost for everyone to point at. If you were playing Henry Higgins in My Fair Lady, where you've got all the vowels in between, you'd never get your choruses to do anything. Because it'd be like, now it's like Pantone color 136. We're using oo number 136. Not going to happen if you're lady. You just need one move, right? So you know, I sing this move. And that's how choral classical choral music is as well, because it's like, let's get the perfect tall ooh that everyone can sing. But here's what you need to know about pop music. Nobody cares. So another thing that'll help, we're still in the first part of Many Layers, but now we can move to part two, which is, it's not about the arranging. And there are more things you can do here, but you get the idea. Number two is about the performance. The thing that sticks out most to you when you hear the King Singer sing is they sing everything with those pure vowels. They sing everything from the perspective of having been in King's College. And painting their bits of barbershop photographs. Like, that's how they sing it. The Beatles sang, with rare exception, they sang pop music with American accents, right? And when they do sing with a British accent, it's kind of funny. And then you hear them talk with that little puzzling, and then you're like, oh, that's hilarious, right? But you hear them singing, you think they're singing, close eyes when I kiss you. They're using those vowels. Tomorrow's not tomorrow, I'll miss you. Which is what it would be if they sang it their way. So American vernacular English is the language of current pop music, which is to say, if you're going to sing or have your group do a popular song and you want them to sound like they're Americans singing in the 21st century, relax the vowels. Have them sing the song the way they'd sing it if they're driving and singing along with the car. Exaggeration, but a little bit of like to tip my hand a little when I was on my last tour of China with the House Tracks. We were having fun, and we'd walk into random places. It started small, but maybe we'd be on the street. And at any time, if somebody went, barbershop tags, the other people would go, barbershop tags. But with that really kind of like that voice, because to the rest of the world, this is what barbershop sings of like. I'm saturating. Singing, blessed moon on our way. People are like, well, I don't know that song, whatever. You're taking me back to 1920. then if you're singing that way with the latest Ed Sheeran song, thinking out loud.
I get it.
Will I tell you things to before? Will my legs go on for it? Immediately, it's an anachronism. It's like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
Like, it's crazy. Any more than the King singer singing, if my legs don't work like they used to before. Right?
Yeah.
Wrong.
It's incongruous.
It's incongruous. It's anachronistic. So, it's actually pretty easy to do this. You just let them go. Now, you don't want really ugly vowels, but also the vowels can change a little bit from thing to thing. And a pop song is going to be different in the country, right? If you're doing the original version of Landslide by Fleetwood Mac and kind of singing the Stevie Nicks way, it's different from the Dixie Chicks.
Yeah.
You're saying a little bit more twine. Now, if you're doing Dolly Parton tune, you can have a little Jolene, which would be more American, Jolene, right? Or Jolene. Like, there are all the different ways you can go there. And it's good to be able to shift gears between them, but I think it's important even to put at the top of your arrangement. Like, if it's for barbershop, it's like, use the vowels and phrasing from the original song.
But we need to build stuff into the arrangements that give them the opportunity to do that in performance. So if we've taken out the iconic bass line or that little doo-doo-doo that happens at the end of every chorus because we picked up a sheet music and just arranged from it, then we remove the opportunity for those groups to make that performance.
And
that's our responsibility, the people in this room.
It is. And also people want to hear some, like I was saying, doo-doo-doo-doo-doo.
Yeah.
If you take that out of under pressure, you're tying the hand on your back. You're like, what song? Like, you're immediately.
You might as well not arrange it.
Not.
Like Sweet Caroline this morning. Sweet Caroline.
Everybody is.
Now, if you're doing some kind of thing and you're doing like a moody ballad version and it's Sweet Caroline, you don't need it, but you don't need it. It doesn't have to be there. But if your arrangement is reminiscent of the original, make sure that those iconic elements are part within there. And also, it's not Sweet Caroline, it's Sweet Caroline. Like, you kind of need it to be, otherwise, it sounds weird. And there's a lot of barber pop, which I'm working on stuff with Gal and Scott and Ryan, whatever, where I'll actually take them and send them my pop arrangement, barbershop eyes it a little bit, and then it goes out. So it's a hybrid world. And hopefully the groups, I know the younger groups that sing it, high schoolers or whatever, it sounds totally current pop American. But then an average age 65-year-old barbershop quartet sings it, and it has a modern barbershop, because that's their language within the chorus. And neither one is wrong. They both work because the song is living somewhere between them.
Yeah. I recognize that all art forms take a certain evolutionary process, and I guess to pass and mixture with whatever other art forms are about at the time.
Right.
We're caught in between where the art form is still to a certain extent allowed to be preserved, which is probably impossible to preserve an art form.
No, it's not.
It takes different. I mean, it has a life.
Yeah.
So we're in between when we should be doing a lot of better quality. You know, there's all the things you're talking about with adding percussion, adding layers, adding different rhythms and vocal sounds, so forth.
Yeah, yeah.
Instrumental sound. So it's sort of between, we have to keep one side of the fence for contest, the other side of the fence, how far do you go? And when I'm listening to some vocal group, for instance, the GQ women,
yeah, yeah,
and their last album, and I mean, it's so wonderful,
yeah,
and I love it all, and I'm thinking, how in the world can I do this? Because it's not, Who wants to sing it? I mean, who can sing it? Like,
well, a lot of the stuff when they're doing water fountains, it's in a sense.
Yes, I mean, there's some.
But then there's other stuff.
Yeah.
So I know what your question is, because it gets to the heart of how do we keep barbershop alive, and yet things are going. I'd say number one, you don't need to run away from what barbershop is and has been. You can do both, and groups should do both. You need the tradition in there, so that's fine. Number two, I think it's okay to look at various eras of barbershop to still be barbershop. The D danger, I think, is to look only at the latest incarnation of barbershop and say that's barbershop. I've been pushing the Barbershop Harmony Society for a few years now to get four black guys together to sing Barbershop the way it was sung in the 1890s. Because if we really want to bring back the tradition, are we preserving barbershop from a barbershop era, or are we preserving barbershop from 1965 when they started, right?
Yeah, and it only has,
you know, well, and I learned this about music
talk. It evolved to 1938 when the society was born.
Right? Well, it'd be like me starting a doo-wop society right now. Yeah, because yeah, right. Barbershop was basically dead in 30 years.
I went to a class on the talk about this at Harmony U, because I was at Harmony U last week. And I was talking about how the men have relaxed their appointments for competition and those kind of things. And what they were saying is that they thought that we were, but the barbershop music for a long time was actually the popular music of the time.
Correct.
Until we got to the point where all of a sudden we codified it with the judging manual, and then we froze. And we froze it at the point where the music at that time did those things that we talked about. And what they said is they now lifted it back off and said, well, let's go back to making barbershop music at this time. And it still falls to the parameters of a current sound, the second melody, the second voice, and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But that's why they have a lot more music that is
from what I understand in Sweet Adeline's world, you have a wider net that you allow during competitions. Mm-hmm. But then when it's the barbershop songs, they have to be more.
There's more fit definition.
Yeah. Right, but then your show package is like, let's do the Doobie Brothers.
When we went to the one song in the performance package requirement, I mean, at those contests, didn't we see the wonderful exploration from different competitors of doo-wop and, I mean, why is it not one kind of quasi-magical, like, I mean, exploring things.
They can't do that in barbershop. So basically, barbershop is trying to do everything within one set of judging parameters, and Sweet Adelines has a wider net. But here's the thing that's going to be hardest for you guys, but it's actually what's going to be barbershop all have. You can't make judging the focus of barbershop.
No.
And it has been. And I've been beating this drum for a long time. Audiences don't care. Whatever the rubric is, whatever the judging parameters are, they don't care. Now, I know the judging is trying to move into the current day. I know judging is trying to go out of its way to create the elements that we need to be more interesting. There are no more coming here. But we can't.
There's no nerves in there. We're having more fun.
There's a danger that happens within barbershop and I think things are getting better now, but the reason nobody cares is because the only thing that anybody who's arranging and rehearsing and performing cares about is impressing the judges. Mm-hmm. And the judges are following the judges' rule book. Mm-hmm. And so we have this terrible, the analogy I mean is both of it. It's like you're all speaking Esperanto. You've created this made-up language that you're all talking to each other.
And it's like internal.
It's internal. I was coaching a couple groups, and they walked on stage, and the first thing they did, and you guys are used to this, so it doesn't seem weird to you, but to me, I was like, they all walk out, and they spread out, and they bat. And then they come back together, and they stand, and they blow their pitch, and then they sing. And I was like, why did you bow? And they said, well, you know, we want to acknowledge the audience's applause.
We haven't done anything yet.
First of all, we haven't done anything yet. Second of all, can you think of any other music where the people come out and they bow formally like that before they've done anything?
Carl said it.
But they don't.
Yeah. Right. It's more than a bow. It's just the audience is applauding. And I believe that it's a communication from the performer that we are accepting your applause and we're ready to sing and I hope you're ready to listen.
I understand it. I'm just saying no.
I don't think it should be a big extravagant bow, and I don't think it was ever meant to be. I think it evolved. Mm-hmm. Somehow.
I'm not sure it's even, but like when the Beatles came on stage, ladies and gentlemen, the Beatles, people were like bleeding out the eyeballs, they were screaming so loud. Yeah. And the Beatles just came right out.
Yeah.
And they came right out, picked up their close your eyes. Right. Bruce Springsteen. Yeah. Prince doesn't walk out and come in before he died. People are going nuts. He didn't come out and think like, thank you. Prince. Because think about it, wouldn't that be weird? Prince is getting 400,000 times the amount of applause any barbershop group ever has or will, let's be honest. And he doesn't feel the need to bow because
his audience is different than the barbershop audiences of 1930, 40, 50, and 60. Because in that era, I believe that Glenn Miller, I mean, they were very polite, and they would applaud for their performers who came out. I'm sure when they introduced one of the big band leaders, he would walk out and he would say, thank you, and then you turn around and start.
Lawrence White.
It's a social
thing. But what I'm saying is, if we're going to take some things, if we want to preserve barbershop as an experience that a modern audience will enjoy, and we don't want to even start off a performance saying, like, this is going to be a little weird, then I would let the bow go. It just, it feels. Leonard Bernstein, if he walked out to an enormous standing ovation and the whole orchestra is there and the orchestra is applauding, the most he would do is nod for a second.
If that.
And often it would just be like, come right out, do your thing, let's make music.
Yeah.
So I don't want to harp too much on that, but there are things within barbershop that have become stylized to the point that the language of barbershop is so internally focused. Another one are all these like, and you do this stuff with your arms that is about phrasing, I get it. But then you see people singing it, it seems so C-3PO.
Unnatural.
And if you're singing songs that you want, here's the thing, if you want music to be communication, you want it to be natural. You want people with feelings, like you just want to feel like, oh, he's just singing from the heart. But if your arms are going like this while you're doing that, it's immediately saying like, they're trying to do something, they're not doing it. I'm a part of an artifice or a performance or a language that I don't understand, so I'm gonna try to appreciate it more than just let it hit me. But nobody at the end of a performance that they appreciated posts about it, tweets about it, talks about it. They're like, they appreciated it. It's like your grandmother coming to your performance when you're in school and saying, that was nice. You don't even say nice when people say that.
So in a Broadway production, a guy has just finished singing for a couple, but just singing their song. And there's the moment where it's done, the orchestra's done, the audience is applauding. It's that little bit of hesitation before they turn and execute the next line, or the next moment of action.
Yes.
That is a courtesy, we hear the audience, but where the wall is down, we're not really, accepting applause, but there's that little hesitation before the show goes on to allow the audience to express their appreciation of what that song was, just what the performance was.
But I don't think you're saying you don't acknowledge the audience, so why don't you just say the
correct
now is...
That's what I'm saying.
Correct.
I think what I did was evolve into an acceptance and a bow and blah, 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 but I agree. I think if we're going to cross over back to what the occupy
well, it's not even the acapella. It's just let's go out to this culture. We can find people here who don't like acapella and don't care about it, or whatever. Let's perform for them.
We have to be aware that maybe those are some of the things we should take on.
Yeah. And the language of performing, the language of arranging, the language of communicating changes over time. And so I don't think barbershop needs to lose the melody being the second voice. I don't think it needs to lose circle fifth progressions. I don't think it needs to lose homophony. But these other things that aren't
cliche,
that you mark the shape, that then you can make real, true, expressive, heartwarming, heart-wrenching music within those theoretical frameworks.
That has a lot of us here in the advanced arranging class.
Exactly. I think that what you need to do when you're arranging is you need to, like I was saying the other day, you have to lead with emotion. You need to go into a song and you need to say, what matters here? What is the core fundamental emotion of the song? Is it sadness? Is it melancholy? Is it joy? Is it fear? Does it start in one place and then there's a revelation and you end up somewhere else afterwards? And then every single flipping decision you make must underline that. Full stop, end of story. If you're adding in an extra light turnaround just because, oh, there's some space in there, I want to turn around. But does that make the audience, like if it's about feeling alone, you should just be sitting on the same chord. Have you heard Take Six do, I'll get your question out
of
here. Have you heard Take Six do the Star Spangled Banner?
Say the word again.
Have you heard Take Six's version of the Star Spangled Banner?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
the first half of it, all six guys sing in unison. Perfect, flawless, unison, and it's chilling. How many of you have thought to have all four of your people sing in unison? Everybody singing, it's like, yeah, I mean, it happens in moments, but that long, like, there's this tension that builds and builds, and then the rockets ring, the layer happens, and it bursts into harmony, and you get chills all over your body, you're like, oh, right? And part of it is knowing what take six is, but more importantly, like, the arranger was clearly making a choice there, like, we're going to withhold, we're going to withhold, and if you're doing a song that's really, like, all about being alone, and I feel alone, then what should it be? It should be one person singing. Maybe it's one person singing alone. Maybe then background parts come in and the chords don't change. Right? There's things like, take that emotion, take the story of the song and make that your thesis, and every dynamic, every breath, everything needs to underline that. And then that's, and then you're already two-thirds of the way there. Otherwise, if you're like, well, the judges really want to hear enough of these chords, we have to get these kind of chords in there, and really the place to put it is in the first verse. But if you're jamming in the first verse, that's not what's going to tell the story best. You've basically just said, this is an arrangement for five judges.
Well, that's what our contest has to be for myself.
So, I guess that's my
question. No, I understand that people are hiring you guys to arrange for contests. But here's what I tell the partnership harmonists. I answer them, it's like, I think, you know what we need? We need a new set of awards. We need one award that goes to the group that gets the most views of all videos. January 1st to December 31st, count up the views that got the most views, you get gold medals. Number two, the group that performs for the most people live. How many tickets did you sell? How many people were there? How many people? Add them all up, send in the numbers, whoever has the most. January 1st of next year, you get an award because you spread your music to those people. And number three, which group has the most new members? Why isn't that an award?
Yeah.
Our chorus grew by 76 members this year. You've just done something that's more important, right? Those should be gold medals, and if those were gold medals, you would have your handcuffs on. Because you're like, I want to arrange something that's going to still be in a barbershop style, but that's going to go viral and get 3 million views. I don't have to do that. You're going to be aimed at a different tone. It's not your fault. You're stuck in the system that is rewarding the feedback.
You know Perpetuum Jazzio.
Of course.
So their Storm of Africa is amazing.
And it has like 20 million views, 30 million.
The idea to start a rainstorm.
Right.
And then the riser, when they're doing the thunder and so on. Amazing. That's all arrangement, right? I mean, the other thing I was going to say is I don't believe that we're stuck. I mean, our chorus starts with 20 straight seconds of unison on a contest ballot.
Great.
All right, but and I also believe that we should be more contemporary with our enunciations. And when you talk about the fact that tuning isn't as important as pop, I contend that if they're in tune with one another and if they actually match one another, whatever they choose, whether it's true gag or whatever, it's going to sound better.
Yes, no, I'm not.
So you're not with a wah, you know, of ours, the old style of ours.
It's not the tune doesn't matter, it's that it's not so much the point.
Okay, but it's better if it's in tune, right?
It's much better.
And if everybody agrees, so my contention is, and I'm not disagreeing, I'm actually agreeing, with conversational. Enunciation. Conversational is so much better than what you say they expect from barbershop in Japan and China because
of that's what you're hearing now from Forefront and Crossroads, that's what you're hearing from GQ, and it's like a new generation that feels, in some ways, it might even sound looser to your ears, but to the general public, it sounds so much more like, oh, that's our.
You throw away the ahs and change them all to us because the tits are better. You know, and so on. And I love the idea of the non-lear word. Like I use din, because there isn't a word to din.
Right.
And at the end is so far forward that it rings really well and better than M's do and so on. But
of course.
You're
absolutely right. So I think the truth lies somewhere too, because there are times when you have to, it's like the diving competition at the Olympics. You gotta do it. Triple Lindy, or you gotta do a double somersault at some point, and you gotta splash properly.
Yeah.
And yet, you also can put in the snacks and whatever. So,
requirements.
The requirements.
Right.
So, then part of it is who's the group, what's the song, how do I create moments in this that are going to be really true and powerful and meaningful and push the boundaries, because it has to stick to the thesis more than anything else.
Yeah. What I get caught up in is when I'm arranging, how much can I involve some of the newer skills in it and still sell it to a chorus for what they want? Are they going to feel comfortable doing it? Or are they saying, oh, it's way, it's too far? I'm still wanting to learn new skills with this. And I'm caught between, are they going to know how to tune the, you know, the six and the minor?
I think what you're seeing,
how are they going to do this?
You've got your groups that have 1 foot more in the future, you've got groups that have 1 foot more in the future.
Exactly.
So it's going to depend. And it may use somewhat to cultural too, because the groups that I hear, when you hear Westminster, or you've got, you know, Fox, of course, and San Francisco's new courses going on, you've got groups like Sirens of Gotham in New York City. Like, when you're surrounded by so much diversity in culture and music and all that kind of stuff, you're probably just culturally more, and you have a more diverse course, you're probably leaning more towards like, well, we can do this, because that's our language.
There's so much of the mentality of preservation of our art form. And there's like the man had advancement and preservation. It's almost to me, it's an opposite thing. If you're trying to advance it, you're going to have to change. And I'm feeling we're going to have to change and rather than fall short of the preservation. Because that's museum.
As
I'm writing my arrangements, I would like to change, and I don't want to give a group something and say, whoa, that's not what we expected here.
Well, and also, you know, there's a letter of the law. So when I saw, it wasn't this year, but it was the previous year's Finals on the Forefront One, Lemon Squeezy came out of their ballad, which David Wright arranged. It ended on a sus4 chord. Didn't resolve.
Yeah.
And I literally, Adam was sitting next to me, and I turned to him and I was like, can't do that. And I asked David afterwards, he goes, it's not in the rule book. So what you can do as arrangers is you can go through and be like, no one ever said it. Because think about that. It's so powerful. There's this sense of longing and lack of resolution.
Yeah.
And it's just faded to nothing.
This is where this group needs to have dialogue with the judges.
Oh boy, do we ever.
So I think that needs to be.
Okay, Carol, you've been so patient.
Well, the cess4 is in our rule book. We have 11 chords and only 11. I mean, and it's been like that for many years. You know, this is our vocabulary, period. And you talked about leading with emotion.
Uh-huh.
Well, if we all saw the performance of Signature in the last contest.
Exactly.
And the Luther Vandross song. And I had a Facebook conversation with Joey Mitchell, who sadly is not here, but she was kind of struggling with it, and she was, and I feel bad speaking for her. Anyway, she was kind of struggling with it, like, how is this contestable? How is this being contestable?
And
I said, Joey, I think that's comparing apples to oranges. The VHS has just defined barbershop in such a different way. If anything, I think that just shows how different our systems have
become. Well, they don't change it.
Not better, not worse. I'm not making a judgment here, just different. And I think your system allows the kind of musical freedom. And it makes that kind of a performance possible. And that's the tension that I think exists here, that I think our members want it. I know that our arrangers want to be able to do stuff like that, and yet we're still constrained.
But I want to put
a little
caveat on there, because as an arranger that arranges for his own group, like when you're saying, your group you're arranging for, I mean, some of us do that, more directors and arrangers.
Right.
Change and evolution, I think, historically comes from the bottom up, not from the top down.
Right.
Whether you talk about government, music, and, you know what I mean, social things.
Right.
And I know what it says in our rule book, 11 chords, but I just know we won a couple of gold medals where I've got, you know, like a pedal tone with a C, middle C on the basses, and I'm rotating a B flat chord above and going parallel and trying to hit above it.
But your chorus is at the point, though, where you
need
to
spot
the
are we talking about a level of performance, or are we talking about the creative arranging to enable the performance?
Right.
But you see, when a chorus is as good as yours is, you can use some of those chords, and the performance is so good that you don't get penalized, whereas a chorus doing the same arrangement at a C-plus or a B-minus level would receive the full brunt of chords.
And there's that balance of doing an arrangement that's within a skill level of any performance,
Here's something that definitely happened, because I got, you know, people asking with huge wide eyes, why did some videos go viral, like those four guys singing under the boardwalk on the Southwest flight? People were like, our group is so much better, barbershops are better than that. They're like a C-level quartet. Mm-hmm. Why did they get millions of views and my quartet can't get 10,000? I said, well, what people are yearning for online is real experiences, real moments. And those four guys were actually just on the flight, and the flight was delayed, and they just leaned in towards the aisle, and they sang some four-part harmony, and they created a wonderful moment. And music is not about perfection, or is it about complexity? And so, I think if you're dealing with a C-level chorus, whatever the personality is, wherever they're from, find out who they are as people. Find out what matters to them, what means a lot to them, what region are they from, what songs touch them, and what's going on in their lives. And find a way to operate. And the song does, it's not about complexity, it's not even necessarily about a bigger harmonic language. It's approaching or reaching from a completely different perspective. And if you feel constrained at times, you're like, but how do we do whatever? Remember Bach chorales.
Mm-hmm.
Four parts, only certain chords. Mm-hmm. Everything had to be within this world, had to be seen in a wise choir. And there's such incredible beauty and genius within the way in which he wrote these, for these very simple hymns, these very simple songs. And he created a language about it. For you guys, it wouldn't be about creating a mind language. It'd be about creating all of these other elements that you can go to, and more importantly, that big emotional pieces. And not every group can sing every song really well. So the song has to be right for them, and maybe part of the situation is, when you've got your C-level chorus, well, we want to sing this song. You can push back and you can say, I don't think you're going to do a great job with that song. It's not who you are. Well, we love the song. But do you want to be great? Because I can get you. You'll sound so good singing this. And yeah.
Could we not think about making a difference within the judging program from the musical standpoint, and bringing in some of the elements that you were talking about, Jim, and maybe adding some of those collective vowel sounds in a pedal tone that we're using, or in some other area.
There's a myriad of things.
Exactly. And if we were to do that and allow the homophonic part of it to be slightly, I mean, ever so slightly compromised, so that we don't insult the judges, but you're looking at a few music judges right here. And so
you're supposed to do what you're told, that's the thing, it's a big cycle.
And we're not going to be able to rewrite the music program, the music category, but I think,
why not?
You sure can, I mean, just was 15 years ago.
Let me finish. Excuse me. Sorry. No, you're fine. But my thought was, we can't do it right here today, but we can do it subliminally with adding various concepts, and they're going to say, well, how did you do that? I think the byproduct of all of this is forward motion, more progressive music that is going to appeal to our younger generations, and I do think it's going to impact membership in a positive way. So I think the long run here is that we have a future to consider, as well as all the geriatrics and all the things. If you look at the attendees at this very event, the age group is very varied, let's just say that.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to guess where the percentages fall, but I would venture to say that there are a lot of general members here who are, let's just say, closer to 50 than not.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, those of us who have been around the horn a few times, we know that we have to reinvent ourselves somewhere, somehow. if we don't keep up with the times, we're going to end up losing everything.
Right.
And so I think we have to approach some of this gently, but positively.
Look, I totally agree. And you guys will, like forward motion will come in a variety of ways from a variety of different sections. So all you can do is as much as you can do, and then that's as much as you can do. But let me put this thought experiment to you. Have you guys heard of the ladies' performance of Fabric the Art, which is now like close to going viral online? The ladies?
Oh, the
ladies.
Our
rising
church.
Oh, they're amazing.
So I was there on New Zealand. They did a breakout walk.
Oh,
it's so amazing. And they sang. I was with them right before that. We had brunch together.
It wasn't GPU's
No, but the ladies' version of it, right. Okay. So they had to go through this tunnel to get back to the center part of town. And I told them, I said, you've got to go through the creepy hallway. And so they got into the creepy hallway, and they were like, ooh, the acoustics are really good in here. And then they just set up their little phone and they shot themselves singing. And now think about that song. Mm-hmm. If you perform it with the proper emotion and you sound good singing it, do you really think the chords matter that much?
No.
They don't, right?
And like, you sing it too.
What's that?
It's the performance opportunity of that song. Where it will be sung is going to be in most likely a song type of setting.
Right.
I don't know what you mean by the chords matter that much. The chords absolutely create the sound.
Right.
But you're talking about, do the illegal chords matter that much? No, they do not.
Well, that's what I'm asking.
To clarify what you were asking.
What I'm asking is, could they have done a stunning rendition of the song with all five?
Sure.
You could do
a contest, but.
No, it's not contestable. What I'm saying is, they could have done a sheet note singing version of it, sure, with fourths and fifths, and it still would have been like, oh.
Yeah.
So, you do have one hand tied behind your back at times with your harmonic language, mm-hmm, but you don't have both hands tied behind your back. Mm-hmm. And when you find the right nexus of song, group, moment, emotional perspective, you can make all of those work. Like, it's not impossible. It's harder, but it's absolutely doable. And that's also where, as arrangers, you can steer a group. Ooh, I know you guys wanted to do this song faster, but if you slow it down, you can really pull some out of the song or whatever. You know, you're the engineers of if it's the Starship Enterprise, you're starting, you're deciding. You're not picking the destination all the time, but you're the engine that moves it forward. How much and how far.
I mean, there's a certain, like, the vocal majority's version of You'll Never Know at contest. At the very end, the basses come up to a, in the tag,
yep,
major seventh. Major seventh, where I'm just like, whoa,
right,
unbelievable. That's literally long. 3-4 seconds long, all right? That's the men. And the VM, of course, Great Reputation, absolutely won. No question about, wow, that was not really a great chord there. It was fantastic. Well, I'm 35 voice female chorus that just won our region. We did the same song, and I had a much shorter version of that major seventh in our tag. Not a single negative comment. So I think they're working together. I think the societies are coming together. But someone had the guts to do it there, and then, you know what I'm saying? I think that it will work.
We need pace setters.
We are definitely, what?
We need pace setters.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think
that. Well, we're seeing some talent contests that would not have been there 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Well, and again,
but that's,
again,
that's part of the evolutionary.
Yes, and you see, I'm just really trying to correct those. Mm-hmm. So for instance, I did Beyonce. The it was a French song on there. Bobby Dare did it.
Of course.
That's,
I performed it with my project.
Oh, it would be on the seat. So, I did.
But
heard the Women do it.
Yes.
I put it. And then I asked a couple of people, one person would say yes, one person would say no. And so, and it was done, and it was done out of style, you know. And I loved it. I mean, I felt it inside, and I wanted that kind of thing to happen on stage. And I don't know how it's done with the judging thing, but it's been in some contests. I had a couple of people, like I said, I got mixed reviews on whether the judges were going to like it, you know, because it was a different presentation.
Well, I can tell you right now, the one who inspired my entire adult career was in Adelines. And they were doing a Christmas album, and they said they wanted the song by Christmas. So I did an arrangement for them by Christmas for RTTVP, and I was really proud of that record. I thought, this is really beautiful. And I sent it to them, and they emailed me back and said, sorry, this just doesn't work for our group. We're not going to do that. I said, oh, let me change it, like, anyway, to tweak it or whatever. They're like, no, it doesn't work for our group.
Yeah.
And I was heartbroken. I was crestfallen. I was like, this is a group I idolize. And I'm like, oh, it's not going to work. And then I got a call from the gas house gang shortly thereafter. Like, we have a Christmas album. We're going to come for another song on it. Do you have anything you can send our way? Like, we're time and the budget. Like, we'd love to do some of yours. And I said, like, I had this arrangement about Christmas I really liked, but, you know, it was rejected. Like, it isn't good or whatever. I sent it to them and they sang it and sounded like angels. And now it's far and away my most performed arrangement within the barbershop world. And also in the contemporary world, like, it's not contestable, but it's four-part, and it just works, and it's lovely. So all of that is to say, there's no account for taste. Like, you're going to find sometimes you're going to do something that's, like, outside of the norm, and some people will love it, and other people, I don't know about that. And as an arranger, there's nothing you can do. And also, for some groups, it'll fit like a glove, and other groups, they'll just sink clunky and it won't work, and you're like, no, that's not what's supposed to work. So that's part of the frustration as arrangers.
It is frustrating.
Yeah, because we have this vision, but it won't necessarily be executed the way that we intended.
I think another part of the solution to this whole issue is accessible music for groups that don't sing at the A level. Mm-hmm. You know, I think there needs to be just good, solid, simple stuff, you know, that presents a song in an interesting way that doesn't necessarily have to have all kinds of, you know, high-level whiz-bang in it that anybody at all can sing.
High-level whiz-bang.
I've seen many amateur groups that I like more than professional groups. I'm a huge Stevie Wonder fan. I have every single one of his albums up in the 1980s. Knew them backwards and forwards, but I saw them perform while I was in college in the late 80s. And maybe he's having off night of everyone.
Who did you say?
Stevie Wonder.
Oh, okay.
He's perfection personified. He's one of the greatest voices of anyone who's ever been on the screen. He's written songs that are more iconic than anything. And he performed all of them that night, and the entire audience was on their feet clapping. And I just looked in his face, and he wasn't. And I felt disappointed after that concert. I was like, oh, I mean, I still love this, listen to his music, but I was like, oh. And there's times I've heard an amateur group, and they're not that great. And then my heart is swelled with joy. So it's possible to arrange a song that's not too hard, that doesn't go step anywhere outside of the chords, but if the group loves it and they sing it with that love, mm-hmm. everybody wins. Yeah. So that's the way to look at it. Again, when it comes to music, it says, like, I need complexity. If it did, Steve Dan would be the Beatles, or you know.
Yes. Well, one thing that gets to me is that there are a lot of, I'd say, probably more male arrangers who do this, who, to me, they're showing off how complex they can do an arrangement. Mm-hmm. How many key changes can they make? And you get these key changes that go up and down, and then all of a sudden it's not about the song. It's not about the message, and it's all about the show off with what skill level.
I couldn't agree more. And yeah. That's what I was saying.
When,
that's what you said in your first.
Yeah, for those people there, if it's not step arranging, it's one of the
ways that you do.
Yes.
Don't make the arrangement about you. Yes. You need to disappear. You want the audience to hear the first chord and just get lost in the song. And at the end, maybe somebody who really understands music just afterwards, like, who came up with that version, or who figured out that they could do it that way? Because most people don't even know what arrangers are. They do do. But it's like you want that transfer. So you want people drinking from the fire hose of truth, honesty, and beauty.
Yes.
You want them absolutely mainlining gorgeous music. And as soon as you get too cerebral, as soon as you get too clever, as soon as an analogy we can do one of groups, you all of a sudden this is part of the problem of judging. It rewards unnecessary complexity, which is something that's almost impossible to weave out of the judging. So the best way to do that is to create guidelines and incentives within the community that have nothing to do with the contest stage, which is why I mentioned this contest about who gets the most viral videos. Here's the thing. You can have a C-level chorus, even the idea that they're C-level feels a little like, yeah, let go of the numbers, you know? But at a 700 master director, all this stuff to me is like, Led Zeppelin never got a Grammy, but that doesn't make them bad. You know what I mean? Anyway, you can have a C-level chorus get a gold medal because they got the viral video. They got the most new members. And that's what it's all about. And I think, I know within the barbershop society, because I've spoken, if I'm guessing it's probably the case here, you've probably got some directors, some group members who are like, we're never going to win anything. We can never be as good as the top five choruses in the country. And it's on a 3-year rotation. Like, we will never, we'd be lucky if we placed in the top 10. Lucky, right? So how incentivizing is that? Like, it's frustrating for them, right?
Yeah, but my chorus came last the first time we came out. This year we're in the Harmony Classic, so it's not a test.
That's not a bad place.
I understand, and it's good that people are working towards it, but as Marty Munson has on a sign above his desk, competitions are mostly for losers.
That's right.
If you think about it, almost every single person who's in a competition loses. So you can't structure it in such a way that winning ends up being the main thing. But more importantly, as a society, if everything's about that competition, then music has become the Olympics. It's become synchronized swimming. It hasn't become art. And this, I don't mean this in any way to be disrespectful towards Sweet Adelines. Any preservation society, any organization, including Barbershop Harmony Society, struggles with these issues daily. The question is, how do you still keep music and make it something that can be competitive sometimes, but not always?
Well, as you pointed out, our judging program is structured to reward technicalities rather than performance.
Those are performance categories.
Yes. Performance, it is, but it's only 25%, and there are musical ears in that category. I totally understand that.
Yeah.
But the fact is that the pressure is on to be united in every technical aspect.
Of course.
And of course, you want the same message done, too. But on the other hand, what happens is that we're building choruses who are competitively oriented. And because they get too large, or because that they don't have time for a lot of performance-oriented music and detail work, they end up being a completely competitive type of chorus, and they miss the boat going out and enjoying.
Right.
They really do.
Also, the larger you get, the more difficult it is to do the kind of agile arrangements.
I'm not saying it's easy.
No, but all I'm saying is that you get over 100, 120 people, I guarantee a 40 or 50 voice chorus could be cleaner with something like that than a large group. And then, and what's it all about is performing for the community too.
Yeah.
So, you know, some are so large they can't be hired by the retirement homes.
And our entire way of life is going to die off if the only people who do it are the very best, and everybody else feels like it's an elitist thing. So we need to, and that's where you guys, you're arranging, look at the times that you're going to arrange for that top three, top five, top 10 chorus or quartet, which, and then it's really fun, you're like, oh, I get to drive this Ferrari, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then other times, you're going to be driving, you know, a rental wreck, you're going to be driving a 1976 Honda with three cars. And you know what? That's when your job as arrangers really, that's where you shine, in my opinion. Anybody can arrange for a great chorus because they're going to make anything sound awesome. How do you make this group sound
awesome
and make people go, oh, I love it, and make their amateur faces light up every time they see you because they love it? You have to make it not only sound good, you have to make it fun to sing.
That's right.
That's your job.
Judy's waiting really patiently.
Okay, Judy.
Before you said, I was going to say, before you said that about the Star Trek banner, I just said a long time ago that I thought most of them were
before, it's pretty boring. So I did one, and I take some of the group, because it starts out with like an octave, the holes are there, the whole thing, while the bass goes, oh, say again,
yeah.
on that C, yeah. whatever like that. And usually when we sing it, people say, that's the most amazing Star Spangled Banner I've ever heard.
Right.
And it's really fun, and it does break a few rules. Anyway, but I, when I was thinking about what you were saying with this, and we're talking about the chords, but in particular, when you started, my mind went to How Great the Art, and I was hearing moving things in there, which I always get, you know, criticized, because that moving part, the second note does not make a barbershop chord.
Yes.
It takes it out of there, yes. and yet it's extremely beautiful. It's not there for very long, so that would be one that I would think would be nice if we could just maybe adjust that a little, because it makes for some pretty things.
Yes.
The other thing I was going to ask is, when we were talking, I'm really fascinated by this, because I mean, I do things with rhythm things, but I'm having them going do 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 da da da. What would you suggest for, I mean, like, and like, instead of, you know, a layer goes ooh, what could you do besides an ooh or a do?
Well, okay, but a couple of things. Number one, if you want some ideas, go to listen to like some pentatonic stuff, because the background parts, sometimes they've got these cool, like, down, down, down kind of sounds. You can make other notes. But generally speaking, think about a syllable as having a beginning and an end. Your beginning is going to be any consonants, be they fricative or palatable or whatever, you teach your B's or K's or whatever. And then, in the middle there, you've got your vowel. Or at least some kind of a resonant sound. Maybe it's a hum or an N. And you can also have diphthongs in there. All that kind of stuff can happen. For example, one sound I'll sometimes use is wow. But if you slow wow down a lot,
wow,
you're actually going from an ooh to an ah to an
wow.
It's, right? It's a vowel sweep. It's a filter sweep. And a synthesizer.
Wow, 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 wow.
If someone sings that,
wow, 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 wow,
you end up taking the word and almost turning it into a synthesizer. And then, of course, like the beginning, you also have ending consonants. So you can take and start to build and block all kinds of sounds. And that's where thum comes in, right? And also, you can use schwas. Another thing that you'll find in pop music a lot is to use schwas, use uhs. Right? Because do or die, it feels so, it's like you've got a little like tie on in your middle school class, right?
Okay.
Like gospel group swap and sing, right?
Okay.
Like it, but who's gonna, you can't sing, oh, that's not a vowel, it's not ooh, it's not pure, but it works.
Okay.
Right? It's beautiful and it's interesting, it feels very modern American and hip. Right? Sing in the cracks. Blues notes are in the cracks. Like, so I also come up with some of that. And you can listen to the way.
You mean pitch cracks?
Hmm?
Do you mean pitch cracks?
Sometimes they sing pitch cracks. The blues scale, and it's like blues scale. The seventh chord. We've tuned everything up, but the seventh chord doesn't exist in the harmonic series. It's, our seven lives between the six and the flat seven. It's not, really have to tune that one, right? Like it's got, when you sing a blues scale and someone's bending on that seven, that's much closer to what happens in the harmonic series than what we are using as a major chord factor to spin our way around the circle of this. So, I would also go and I would get inspiration. Listen to Western music. Listen to Indonesian music. Listen to, you know what I mean? Listen to the way Australians sing Australian songs.
I've hardly been outside my room for days. Missy Higgins, if you would like to hear someone sing pop music with a really flat Australian accent, look up Missy Higgins.
Awesome. So
anyway. Rest of Australia will not pay you for sharing that with you.
And here's, very good. And because I think we're out of time, here's the last thing I'll leave you with. If you need inspiration, don't only look to vocal music. Sometimes you can look at the way that a theater piece, like Hamilton, is paced. How they come out of the gate performing. Look at visual arts and figure out how is this framed? What's my feeling when I move into the room and I see how this is happening? Like, if there are things about the human experience that then you can find a way to translate to vocal music. I know this sounds very obtuse, but you guys are working at a really high level. You probably exercise most of the idioms, cliches, pushed up against the boundaries or whatever, but like you were saying, most arrangers would never think that snapping and then rubbing your hands, I mean, it's something we used to do in summer camp, right? It's a great brain, but it's fantastic and it transports the audience in, and they also realize, like, the sandwich requires doing this thing. So look outwards. And that's where we also started to integrate body percussion into what's going on. So you have these cool body percussion things. I mean, look what happened with the cup song. And it ends up with a plastic cup, and then 4 million copies were sold. So there's stuff out there from summer camp. That came from summer camp too, from other parts of your life, from Broadway, from Twilight Park Dance Company. Like, there's stuff out there from the latest techno music, and see what you can steal. Like I said, steal, don't fall, steal, and integrate that into your arranging. That'll give you some real fresh ideas and stuff. Anyway, you guys, anything I can do for you, or any ideas you have in the future, or questions, whatever, drop me on DeekDeekSharon.com. I'm there for you.
It's Deke.
We're in this
deep.
That's it. Sharon, it's Deke at DeekSharon.com. Or you can find me on Facebook, Twitter, like, I respond to all of them.
Cool.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.